Welcome to BizMag Podcast. I am Dr. Vanita Agarwal, CEO and founder of Love Strategic Advisors, which is a M&A higher education advisory firm. We also proudly produce our business strategy e-magazine, which is read over all across the world in more than 40 countries, with articles from international experts. And we have this BizMag Podcast, where international entrepreneurs, startup launchers, book authors, life coaches, mentors, financial experts, and many more come to share their journey and share their tips with the audience so that our audience can transform their lives in some better way.
Here we are having our guest of today, Tehmina Watson. Tehmina Watson is an immigration attorney and founder of Watson Immigration Law in Seattle, Washington. She has helped hundreds of individuals in American business navigate the complexities of U.S. immigration laws to unite loved ones and talent. Welcome, Tehmina, to our show. We are honored to have you on our podcast today.
I'm so grateful, Dr. Agarwal. It's such an honor and pleasure. And I was just saying to her earlier that I love that I can go to India from the comfort of my little room.
So Tehmina, my first, thing would be to know, as our topic is immigrant entrepreneurship in the U.S. So what is it all about? How would you explain it to our audience who are wishing to go to U.S. Or immigrate to U.S., in future after COVID is over, who are planning? Even I also think sometimes that my son should go and settle in U.S.,
Yeah, well, it is obviously a wonderful place to live in. And I feel very grateful and privileged that life has brought me to America. And as an immigration attorney, I see so many people who want to have the American dream come true. And part of the American dream is entrepreneurship, having your own business, having the ability to run it and make it profitable and have it be helpful to everybody around you. And a large part of my clientele and friends are actually from India. And I see how creative people from India are, how hardworking they are. And what stops them are two things. There are not enough visas, meaning green cards, to go around for Indian citizens. And number two, there aren't visa categories specifically for startup founders. So over the last 10 something years, I've advocated for a visa category for startup founders. It led to me writing my own book, this one here, I don't know if you can see it, in 2015, called The Startup Visa. And the second edition of that book will be released in July this year. So I hope your listeners will find the book when it comes out in mid-July. So the question is, how can they come here? Now, if you have a business already in India, and I see these people all the time, you can actually use that entity to come to the US on something called an L visa. It's essentially a multinational transfer visa. But not everybody has that opportunity. Not everybody has the opportunity to create your own business wherever you are. And many things stop you. You need the continuous income from the job that you have. And while you're doing that job, you're dreaming of this amazing thing. In India, like many other South Asian countries, there is a thriving startup scene. It's very exciting, and it's creative and innovative. For that group of people, we now have something called an entrepreneur program. It is not a visa. It is permission to live in the US and work on your business. And it requires that you have investors in the US. So a lot of investors who are in the US, American investors, they have funds in Singapore, in Hong Kong, and these days even India. If you are a startup founder and you have the backing of an American investor, at least in the amount of $250,000, then you can actually come to the US with that backing. And this is very new. We had this installed by President Obama, but the previous president took it away, and then President Biden restored it, which means now people can use it. And it started, it was restored May 11th. And I think it's a really great opportunity for people to be able to come to the US for their startups. Now, the question a lot of listeners may ask is, well, even if I get it, how long can I stay? And it's initially given for 2.5 years. And then you can extend it for another 2.5 years. So in total, you get 5 years. 5 years is a good amount of time to get a business up and running and stable. And the hope is that once it is stable, you can either apply for a green card or you could get a different visa. And all of these should be possible depending on the success of your business. And so for your listeners, I would direct them to a couple of places. Number one, on our website, watsonimmigrationlaw.com/blog, we have a frequently asked question section. And it's called the Entrepreneur Parole Refresher for Founders. And it goes through the requirement one by one by one. And so that would be a good place for people to learn about the program. The other place would be, I just started to write for the Entrepreneur magazine. It's an international online magazine, and I know everybody should have access to it. I have a couple of articles in there. One has just been published. Another one will be coming out soon. And I think they will be very useful for people who are just wanting to explore what this is about. Can I qualify? And all of those other things. The benefit is, a lot of your listeners might know that when somebody is in the US on an H-1B visa, and it's the most popular visa category in the country, a lot of the times the spouses cannot work. They do not have permission to work. But in the entrepreneur program, the spouse is actually allowed to work. So it's another bonus. And so there are many good things about it. Is it perfect? No, but it is a great start. So I'm so grateful, Dr. Agarwal, you're giving me the opportunity to inform your listeners, because I think this is going to be very important for them to know.
Sure, it would be definitely useful for my listeners. And thank you, Tamina, once more to come and share your information, knowledge, and expertise with my audience. Tamina, on one note, you mentioned that you're writing articles in one magazine. So we do have a globally read magazine, business magazine, where we also look for such articles. So it would be great if you want to submit. Yeah, if you want to submit one article of yours. We would be happy to have it on our magazine. It's a monthly magazine, and it is published online, circulated digitally. And, you know, article always remains on site forever till the site is running. Yeah,
I'd be honored. Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation. I love writing. I love informing.
And we are looking for such writers, and we are having regular writers. You see who are writing since my first edition.
That's amazing. I write for two national magazines. One is The Entrepreneur. The other one is called Above the Law. It's a national law magazine. And I write, every other week. And I'm writing about the things that are affecting my clients. A lot of the times, and again, with the COVID situation, particularly with the surge in India, a lot of my clients are affected. So I'm writing about these things all the time. And one of them is, you know, you probably know this, and some of your listeners will appreciate it. A lot of green card holders who are Indian citizens have gone to India and not been able to come back. Because of COVID, because of the high risk situation. And if you are outside the United States for more than 12 months as a green card holder, it's very difficult to come back. You know? And so if you have listeners who are in that situation, I would say to them, come back as soon as you can. Right now, the government has some mercy they're being nice to some people and not others. And so if you can get on a plane and get back, it will be beneficial to, you know, keep hold of your status. And I write about that in one of my articles. Your listeners will actually be able to find that article and make sure they use it. I want people to use these for information and empowerment.
That's a very good tip, because COVID has definitely impacted in some things. People are not aware of these small, you know, things. They all generally forget in all the struggling situation, all of a sudden catastrophe that has happened. You know, they tend to forget such small, tiny details, which can put them at a large problem. So, Tehmina, on that note, I will ask you questions. There are a lot many cases. You know, so many Indians are working and so many other nationalities might be working, because ours is a global program. So I will talk about all the global citizens, whichever country they belong to. Immigration problems might be same for all, particularly those countries, like you said, India, where visa is required to enter any other country. You do not have, like UK citizens, that only on passport you just move to anywhere. You just need to have your passport. You don't need those visas in particular. So, you know, there are so many cases if you find on internet, and few of my known ones also, be it a student who wanted to spend his summer vacation with a relative in US, got tourist visa issued, went to the airport, from there to an intermediary, you know, transition airport, and where he was get hold by the US immigration officials, who forced that, who accused him of, you know, that you are going for job and you're hiding that status. Now, as a student, he might have applied to so many companies worldwide, not particularly in US, and that data was there, obviously, but it did not mean that he was going for that purpose. And he obviously scared, he signed those documents, and now there was a black cross mark on the passport and the visa revoked, and he was turned back. Similar things has happened with the housewives who were going to unite with their husbands who were working in US for a smaller period of time on US visa, or the old parents. So many cases you can find on internet. Now, how can they get their US visa back? Because situation cannot continue, you know, the spouse working there, or son working there and parents are here, they want to go finally for some time. So how, what is the process? And these are middle class people, they cannot afford a very high fees of US attorney, and sometimes they do not have connect also. So what is a real easy process?
That's a really good question, Dr. Agarwal, and I would love to come back and talk about some of these issues. Maybe you can make a list of them that you see and we can go through them one by one by one. But for this particular situation, whether it's a student coming to visit for the summer, whether it is the spouse coming to see, or whether it's a parent just coming to visit for a short while, or whether it's just to come and see Disneyland, whatever that case might be, they're coming here on a visa called B2 visa. It's a tourist visa. And the B2 visa is purely to visit. You're visiting here temporarily. You cannot have intent, meaning the intention, to live or work here. Now, when somebody is of young age or marriageable age, or even married to somebody who's working here, suddenly the government doesn't look at you as if you're telling the truth. Everything you say is looked at with suspicion. And so for those situations, I always say to people, hey, be confident in your response. The trouble is that it's such a scary situation in those rooms. You know, there are three or four officers, sometimes eight officers. That's how it's been described to me. Sometimes they have guns on them. It's hard not to be scared. Sometimes you just want to sign just to get out of there. And in that atmosphere, if you are coming in here, you actually don't have the right to a lawyer. And so having legal advice before you enter is very important, because then you know the things that you need to be able to express properly. Because if these people are coming, they are truthfully coming for a temporary visit. They're just not expressing themselves properly. So sometimes it's useful to have evidence on you about your job in India, your house in India, your very sick parents in India that need you, other responsibilities that will take you back home. Because then you can tell the officer, look, I really am here for 3 weeks or 3 months. My husband works here. If I wanted to get a visa, I could have gotten it at the embassy. I do not want to live and work here. I'm only visiting. You have to convince them. There's not an awful lot you can do when you're in that situation. Now, what you describe is after they've basically confessed, and I will tell you that when I was visiting my fiance, now husband and father to my two children, I would have these experiences. I had personal experiences where, you know, I really didn't want to live and work here. I would honestly tell them I'm here to see my boyfriend and then fiance, that I am coming for a short while. Yes, I've got a job. I've only got a, you know, 2 weeks break. I'm coming. You have to convince them that you have a life outside of US. Now, when that visa is revoked, that is when it becomes very difficult. Because what you have to do is go back. Sometimes they can give you a 5-year ban. Because what happens is they ask you the same question 50 different times in 15 different ways. And if you are not telling the truth, you will slip up and say, yes, I'm going to go for school or I'm looking for a job. The moment you say that you are looking for a job, immediately they're going to think you came here for that reason. So having advice before you travel is actually very important. Most people I see are very much like what you say, that they're only coming here for temporary reasons. It's a matter of making sure that you express yourself properly. Now, if that visa is revoked, you have to go to the embassy. If you have a 5-year ban, you have to then file a waiver. The waiver is to say, I'm really sorry I lied. I really didn't mean to. I misunderstood or whatever the case might be. Please forgive me. I'm going in. I need a visa. Now, that's what you can do, but it may or may not succeed. And so the difficulty is that once you are, quote unquote, blacklisted, it's difficult to come out of that. But what I say to a lot of my clients is the universe has a plan. You know, go to Canada, go to Australia, go to the United Kingdom. The world is a very big place. And if you have a great idea, you want to explore things, you know, wait it out. Wait out the 5 years by visiting other parts of the world and then come back in. Because a lawyer cannot make the approval happen. We can file a really good case. Sometimes it will succeed. Most of the time it will not. And what I tell my clients is, you can only control what you can control. And you can't. It's very, and you know, I don't know about you, but it's difficult not to be upset about things you cannot control, but really it doesn't help you. And so I really try to express to people that make the most of the situation you're in and, you know, be in charge of it, take charge of your life and do the things you can do.
That's very inspirational, Tehmina, and very good tip that whosoever is going should consider all possibilities. Generally, you know, even me, when I go out, I never think that it can be a problem. I feel like I have money, I have passport, valid passport, and I have valid visa, so who can stop me? You know, because my intent is clear. But you never know what will happen. So it is good to have legal advice or some information before you barge out. That's a good point. And one point I would like to know on the behalf of listeners, like you said that one can go to embassy for a waiver. Should it be at the time when you have something in your hand to go again?
You should give it a little time after whatever incident has happened. Because you need to figure out, you know, I tell everybody, every case is a story And your story has to be reasonable. If you've been denied and you come back in and you apply immediately, have a good reason for that. Maybe there's a conference you need to attend. You know, maybe there's a meeting you need to attend.
Exactly.
Have evidence of that. Every case is different, and it's a case by case decision on what you do next.
Great. So Tehmina, do we have some time to ask next question?
I'm afraid I have to run, but I would love to come back if you make a list of questions. I love empowering people. And I think you seem to have an amazing group of people who are sending you real life problems, you know, that is happening to them on the ground.
I think I'm a social person. I love to listen to people, and people love to share their stories to me. And that's how I get to know. So
well,
thank you so much.
Let's chat again sometime soon. But sure. In the meantime, I'd love for people to keep an eye on the book. This is my first edition, the Startup Visa. The second edition will be a blue cover, and it will come out in July. But I have a podcast called Tehmina Talks Immigration, and there is a new series called the Startup Visa where you can hear about it. And if people want to visit my website, it's watsonimmigrationlaw.com, and they can find out about me and all the things that I do and ask questions.
So dear audience, here is Tehmina Watson, the immigration law expert from US. If you have any queries, any doubts, please reach out to her. As she explained, her website is there, blog is there, where you can find already published doubts and answers. She has written two books. She has her blog. I would love to listen to some of her podcasts, definitely. She's such a lovely speaker. Thank you so much, Tehmina.